So Manu, it's such a pleasure to meet you, and I've been reading this book, and as you can see, I've done a whole lot of color coded tabs I've put on it.
So it's very flattering.
Understand what you're talking about.
Yeah.
Now what's interesting to me that at this particular time, when so much is being talked about history and there's a narrative of us versus them, that you talk of Vijayanagar sultans, something which I don't think many people know, that the Vijayanagar kings call themselves sultans,
yeah,
and of the Bahmani kingdoms. So the Vijayanagar and the Bahmani, how they often sided with each other, they fought with each other, and it was always all about power, never a religious narrative.
Yeah. The thing is, you know, we've fallen into this trap of seeing everything as a clash of religions, which is really our failing rather than a mature understanding of the past. Because as you mentioned, what you see in Vijayanagar and the Bahmani kingdom is often politics explained in the vocabulary of religion. And that was something that, you know, even, I mean, in Europe, that's how they justified a lot of their wars. It was always in the name of God, but in reality, the intentions were greed, politics, things that were much more earthly. It's a little bit like that in Vijayanagar. In fact, they started calling themselves Hindu sultans, Hindu Raya Surat Rana, in the 1340s. That's one of the that's the time when the Sangama brothers first start using this title. It's fascinating because on the one hand, they felt this is perhaps one of the earliest instances of a Hindu family appropriating what was a word used by foreigners and applying it to themselves. But they're also appropriating the concept of a sultan because they've realized that the geopolitical landscape, the strategic landscape really of India itself has changed. There are northern sultans, there are Muslim sultans in the north, and they see themselves as Hindu sultans. And it's something that they continued using for 2.5 centuries, the idea that they were Hindu sultans. And it, you know, there's one of them who even called himself Gola Surat Rana, Sultan of the World. So it wasn't a title they took lightly or, you know, as just for the sake of it. They really saw some power in the title and they wanted to use it, just like they applied the word Hindu to themselves. As for, you know, the idea of religion in all of this, you see that this is one of the great ironies, which is that, you know, one of the greatest rulers of Vijayanagar, in fact, the emperor who was in control when the city finally collapsed, he spent his early career as a nobleman in the court of the Qutub Shah of Golconda, who's, you know, it's one of the kingdoms that appears in the book. Similarly, that particular Qutub Shah in his youth had lived in Vijayanagar for 7 years. He'd married a local Telugu woman. His name he Teluguized from Ibrahim to Malik Brahma. And then he went back and he patronized poetry on the Mahabharata. So there was a lot of exchange between these families, between these royal families, between the gentry, the nobility, all these people. The great battle of Talikota, everyone presents the fall of Vijayanagar as the destruction of a Hindu empire by Muslim kings. They were Muslim kings and it was a Hindu kingdom that fell. But it wasn't a Hindu-Muslim war because on the side of the Vijayanagar people, there were Muslim generals from the time of Devaraya II. In fact, in that region, the Kadamba kings had, you know, Muslims in their court coming from the coast. Similarly, on the side of the sultans, at that battle in 1565, there were about 6,000 Marathas fighting for the Muslim side. So it wasn't a Hindu-Muslim thing. They would have justified their respective actions in the name of religion. But you can draw parallels to something like that even now. Look at, for example, the BJP. Officially, you know, cow slaughter is bad, beef is bad or whatever. But in the Northeast, they say, "Acha khana hai to khao." In Kerala, they'll say, "Acha khana hai to khao." The point is that your official self-image is not necessarily how you actually negotiate politics on the ground. When it came to that, it was money, it was who had the larger army, who had access to the best Persian horses, Arab horses, you know, who was really playing the politics better. So I think, you know, that is the reality of it. And the more you delve into this past, you realize that they weren't very different from us. You know, our mistake often is in thinking that they were somehow products of a different universe. They lived in a different time and in a different context. But their basic impulses were the same as ours. Their basic motivations were the same as ours. And on the Hindu-Muslim question, now, there are some fascinating texts. So, you know, the Raya Vachakamu, which is it's a Telugu text, it emerges, you know, in the early 17th century. And you have this remarkable thing where they say that, you know, it's full of polemics against Muslim kings, the sultans of the Deccan. So there's the Adil Shah, the Qutub Shah, and the Nizam Shah, the three sultans of the northern Deccan. And it says, oh, these people are terrible, you know, people are being cut to half in the streets in their capital, they're full of greed, cows are being slaughtered, all of that. But the same text, if you read this section, you think, clear, you know, Hindu-Muslim divide here. But if you read the same text, it also puts the Mughal emperor at some divine level as blessed by Hindu gods. So the Gajapati in Orissa, who's a Hindu dynasty, he's blessed by Lord Jagannath. Tirupati is connected with Vijayanagar. And the Mughals are portrayed as blessed by Kashi Vishwanath. So it's again not a Hindu-Muslim thing. You see that these sultans were enemies of Vijayanagar, but they had no issues with the sultan in Delhi. You know, one of the fascinating things is there's this descendant of Firoz Shah Tughlaq called Fath Khan, I think. He was living in Vijayanagar and he actually came into Vijayanagar as an exile. He didn't choose to live in the Muslim courts of the Deccan. He didn't choose Ahmednagar, he didn't choose Bijapur or Golconda where there were Muslim sultans. He went all the way to Vijayanagar and he tried to persuade the king of Vijayanagar, a Hindu, to help him regain the throne of Delhi. Which meant that they knew their identities were distinct, but it wasn't that wasn't the guiding principle of their politics. Their politics was still as politics is today. The reality is one thing, the vocabulary is something else.
One of the fascinating paintings that you put here was the cow-faced angels.
Yes.
So you have all that kind of cultural exchange also happening. You have that book that you mentioned, I think, Nujum, where you are talking about all the Hindu gods and everything.
In fact, it's not just regular Hindu gods. In this particular text that was patronized and possibly partly authored by an Adil Shah of Bijapur, it's obscure Hindu gods, it's tantric gods, you know, and all kinds of avatars and formats. And that painting that you refer to, which appears in the book, is cow-headed angels. So they're angels in the Islamic concept, except they have the heads of cows and wings. It's just, you know, bizarre if you look at it. It's a very richly done painting, but it's also bizarre, but it's also very interesting, showing that they were actually absorbing all kinds of influences from all kinds of places. And, I mean, look at the characters as well. Now, Ibrahim Adil Shah II, who's perhaps one of the most charismatic figures in the book, look at his ancestry. So, the Deccan was a magnet for a whole host of foreign adventurers. People came here to make fortunes, they came to the Deccan to make their careers. So, you have this one mercenary getting off a ship called Yusuf. And this is in the late 1400s. And he says suddenly, oh look, I'm actually secretly the son, the long lost son of an Ottoman sultan. It's fascinating, no? Like you get on a ship and you reinvent your identity. Gets off here, becomes a military man for the Bahmani sultans who were then in power. Marries the daughter of a Maratha nobleman. And this lady, it's actually a political alliance of sorts, but she also shows that she has influence. Because one or two generations later, when she has a grandson who's not quite up to the mark, she has no issues blinding him, putting him to the side and placing an illegitimate grandson on the throne. Because even the woman, once she was in the sultanate that her husband built, she's very much part of that structure. So the Maratha-Persian blood affected this dynasty thereafter. So where one ruler like Ismail Adil Shah, the second of the Adil Shahs, would highlight the Persian side of his family, would speak only Persian, all his soldiers were dressed in Persian uniforms. You have an Ibrahim Adil Shah II who highlighted the Marathi. He was more comfortable in Marathi, his favorite mistresses were Maharashtrian women. He called himself the son of Guru Ganapati and the pure Saraswati, went to the extent of renaming his capital Vidyapur after the goddess Saraswati. And he was very much a man of local influences. The Persian influence was secondary as compared to the Marathi influence, which meant that these people were constantly sort of building on it. They weren't part of a black and white world. It was various influences coming in. This is a man born, in the Oromo tribe, it is believed, back in Africa, enslaved, carted off to Baghdad. From there, he shipped off to the Deccan, comes here and discovers that he's been purchased by the Peshwa of the Nizam Shah. Now, the Peshwa is essentially the prime minister. And the Prime Minister himself is black. And this guy realizes, there's lots of opportunity in this country, I can become someone. So over 25 years, he builds up a reputation as a more or less middle level general. And then suddenly the Mughal onslaught and their attack on the Deccan opens up a space for him to rise. And you realize that who were his associates? They were leading Marathas of the day. The Nizam Shahi court had Shivaji's maternal family. The Jadhavs were leading noblemen of the Nizam Shahi court. Shivaji's paternal grandfather, Maloji, was a close associate of Malik Ambar. And Shivaji's, the Shiva Bharata, which was patronized and composed in Shivaji's court in the 1670s, it actually has high praise for Malik Ambar. Malik Ambar is called in one line as brave as the sun by Shivaji's court poet, which meant that even Shivaji had only admiration for this black African Muslim who had come off from a foreign land and actually helped protect the Deccan for 25 years from the Mughals. He essentially, what Shivaji did two generations before Shivaji, Malik Ambar was doing the same thing.
So he was Shivaji in fact copied the guerrilla warfare that was so successful against the
Mughals. So Malik Ambar and the early Marathas start developing guerrilla warfare together, and Shivaji, what we see is essentially perfecting something Malik Ambar has already started. You know, but these are the nuances and the details that are often eclipsed or deliberately sometimes, you know, watered down.